Hey, it's Fran again at the bench. Deja vu. Didn't I just do a video about this? Yes, this is the Packard 7-digit Pneumatron driver board. I showed how I got this all fired up, but when I did my demonstration, I was just illuminating one digit at a time, just cycling through, not really multiplexing, which is the next step, because multiplexing a board like this is different than just getting one digit to light up like I did in the first video. And in order to multiplex this, I've got to up the frequency. I've got to switch between the tubes at a rate where the persistence of vision will make it seem like they're all on at the same time, but they're not. This is how pretty much all displays run. So I wrote another sketch on the Arduino. This time what I'm going to do is I'm going to cycle through the tubes, not at full speed, but at a speed about like 1/10 of a second per, so that you're going to see it cycle. And I'm going to just change the digit. I haven't gotten fancy enough to actually display a different digit on everyone. It's just going to say the same digit. It's just going to count from 0 to 9 and recycle. But you're going to see the scanning going on through the tubes. Also, for the first demonstration, I powered the commons, which were going through these switching transistors, right, this bank of switching transistors. These are turning on each tube individually to a common rail. Now, for the purposes of the first demonstration, I tied that common rail to the 5 volts because I was only going to show one tube at a time. But as I ramp up the cycle of the frequency, the amount of time that each tube is going to be on is going to be dropping. And when you actually multiplex it, you're going to have to up the voltage on the common rail, because although these are supposed to operate at 5 volts, if I put on a 5 volt supply and then run the multiplex, you're basically going to be seeing 1/7 the brightness. But in order to just to get a feel for where the ballpark is for this display, I'm going to have a second power supply for the commons so that we can regulate that individually and try to find, you know, where brightness would be for a display like this. All right, so two different power supplies. I got them both set at 5 volts right now. So let's turn on the first supply. Okay, so now the board's on and the program's running. I've got to turn on the second supply just for the display. Let's do that. All right. So this is the slow scan. So this is multiplexed, but at a very low frequency. It's just 1/10 of a second, 100 milliseconds per digit. But this is what multiplex displays are doing. And if you've ever tried to shoot an old multiplexed digital clock with a smartphone, if you've got the shutter rate up high enough, you'll see this very effect. So now what I want to do is I want to write another sketch where I up the frequency, like, you know, to just a few milliseconds for each pass, and try again. I've uploaded a fast scan sketch. I've reduced the delay between the different segments from 100 milliseconds down to 5. So we're still going to be able to see a flicker, but it's going to be much faster. It's not going to be up to full speed, I don't think, yet. So, primary power to the board. We've got the program running. Okay, secondary power. All right. Look in here. Here we go. Look how dim it is. And we're going 5 volts. That's 5 volts on the rail. And they're just barely on. I'm going to turn on the ambient light here a little bit. They actually look really pretty. Oh, that's the beauty shot right there. All right. So that's 5 volts. So let's take up the voltage a little bit here. Okay, so now we're up to like 7 volts. see a little flicker. It's not coming up on the camera just because I'm running a slower exposure on the main camera, but with my eye I can just barely see it flickering. Alright, this is my, I'm just bringing out my much faster camera just to be able to demonstrate the flicker that I'm seeing here. This is at 1/350th exposure, and you can definitely see the flickering effects. And if I take the, yeah, there you go. So now you're definitely seeing that timing issue. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to reprogram this to speed up the frequency a little bit more. Drop it from 5 milliseconds down to 2 milliseconds. That should just be enough to eliminate the flicker and optimize the display. So let's give that a try. Time to reprogram. Now I've got my 2 millisecond scan sketch in. And let's try this again. All right, verify that. Okay. Main power, secondary display power. Forgot to change the frequency of the sketch. It's like running tenths of a second, so forgot a zero. Okay, but that's fine. But the display itself, it is not flickering at all. It's pretty pleasant. And now again, we're running 7 volts. If I put it down to 5 again, 5 volts, which is standard power, you can see it, but the thing is, because these filaments are being turned on and off very, very quickly, the inrush current and such, there's really just not enough voltage to get the individual little filaments to incandesce at that voltage. So you have to increase the voltage to decrease the time that it takes for the filament to get up to operational heat. Although I must say, it is a very pleasant color. No matter how I try to shoot this, it always comes up being kind of a brighter yellow, but it's a really kind of a very pleasing orange in real life. Yeah, I can't really get the color to come up, but anyway. So there you go. Multiplex display. Now that I've got the frequency right, I can write a sketch to display any number that I want on any digit I want. It's just now that I have the frequencies, I just have to synchronize the display digit with the actual number, and that's a completely different kind of a program rather than just a simple loop like this. You know, I have to basically set up a sketch where I have variables for each individual location and then change that variable, you know, basically registers, have 7 registers, and then change those registers, and then in the loop for the display it would basically be displaying those registers in a particular sequence all the time, and that's how, you know, you get the numbers to appear how you want. But, yeah. But let me show you the breakdown of the circuit, since now we're in the super nerdy, boring part of the video. Everybody else has already left. You're still curious. Let's go to the FranCAD. Alright, okay, this is my barely legible hand-drawn schematic, but this is what that board is doing. There are 7 outputs from the SN74141, and each of them goes to one of these driving transistors, the 2N4403. These are PNP power transistors, up to 600 milliamps dissipation, up to 40 volts. So yeah, they're going, you know, heavy duty on this. Just 2 resistors and a transistor for each one of those digits, and this is the tube supply rail, which I was varying there. And then the outputs of those switching transistors are going to the commons on each numatron. Now the diode arrays, you know, when I made the first video, I was like, well, why did they really need the diodes? But really, when you draw it out, you see why. Because if you were only powering a single numatron with a single 7-segment display driver, you would not need diodes. You could go direct drive. But when you tie them together with other neutrons in an array like this, the diodes become necessary because you have a common, and because these are incandescent, when you add an extra tube in the array, each element ends up completing a circuit through the common of the next tube. And if you didn't have diodes in this array to separate each individual element, then every time that you would try to energize any single element, just dimly glow 8. Because you were just basically accumulating all the resistance of all the different filaments all in one big long chain. That would be the problem. So that's why they have to have the diodes with these incandescents with the commons. Here's another thing about this, since now we know how this works. So why then, if we know that these are arrays of just 7 diodes in a block, why did they use these obviously not cheap custom-made potted arrays of diodes? Why didn't they just put in 7 diodes? It would have been a lot cheaper, maybe like 30, 40 times cheaper, just to use individual little signal diodes. Why go for the potted bricks of diodes? Well, this boils down to manufacturing rules, because when a company is deciding to make something like this display board, they really want to get down to the bottom dollar. And when you're manufacturing circuit boards, even today, the number one thing that a company is concerned with is how many mistakes are being made, how many boards fail quality control, how many components are going to have to be replaced, boards have to be repaired. That is really the huge cost of manufacturing, is if you have a lot of duds. At the time that this board was made, which it's got a date code, 1971, on the circuit board itself. So in the early 70s, this kind of manufacturing, it was still done by hand. This board was hand-assembled by people, women, really, let's be honest. It's like 97% of all of the people who work on assembly lines are women. That's even true today. And back then, it was 100%, believe me. Management was all male, but the people who did the work, they were all ladies. Be clear. Props to the ladies. So, a board like this, all the components would be manually inserted by hand, and then the board would be wave soldered. It would be put in a machine where a wave of liquid solder would flow over the board just barely, and as the wave of solder goes over the top and the bottom, it would leave not only solder in the joints, but also coat all the traces with solder, which is why in this day and age, you know, we're talking the 70s, they didn't really use solder mask, and they didn't bother to plate the copper because it was going to be plated with solder, so it served many purposes. But in order to get the board populated, that had to be done by hand. And in the case of this, where they're going to have 49 discrete diodes on a board, 49 components that have to go one way, not like resistors, which could go either way. If you get a resistor backwards, it's not going to affect the board at all. But if you get a diode backwards, or you break a lead, or you forget to put a diode in place, then that is a board that's not going to pass quality control, and it's going to have to be either chucked or repaired. And also, the amount of time that it would take to manually insert 49 individual diodes into a board, as opposed to just inserting 7 blocks that are already spaced and have the dip package, well, we're talking a tremendous difference in time. All of that adds up to what a manager who's trying to figure out how to design this board is going to decide. So, in the mind of the corporation, they would much rather spend 30, 40 times more on a component that's custom made to cut the quality control issues down, and then just kind of pass that on in the expense of the board, save the headaches, and that's why they use these bricks. You know, truthfully, you know, eliminating discrete components and moving these kinds of switching arrays on transistors and moving them onto chips in dip packages, that really was what innovation in the 1970s was all about. It was all about getting rid of the discrete stuff and putting everything onto chips, which could be arrayed on boards and reduce the component count regardless of cost. And ultimately, as everything got shrunkified and put onto chips, and you could get a chip to do switching and power switching and, you know, get arrays to do kind of whatever you want as the 70s went on, well, then the cost of manufacturing dropped tremendously because, again, even if you're paying more for a chip than buying all the components individually, you're saving on the manufacturing cost and you're saving on the errors. But that's really why they did it this way. So yeah, there you go. All right, well that's it for this one. Thanks for watching. Thanks too to all my patrons down on the Patreon. I wouldn't be able to do anything without my patrons, so thank you, thank you, thank you. Everybody on Patreon, you know, if you like what I do, if you like any of these weird, crazy videos, then, you know, help keep me doing it. Just go to the link in the description, become a patron, and I will thank you personally. Yeah. All right. I'm Fran. I'll be back doing something else real soon. I'm Fran.